link here, or you'll probably have to get them through the LinkedIn one as well, shortly. And secondly, the session is being videoed, and that will be up on my YouTube channel in the conferences playlist by the end of Friday, almost certainly. So if you just search in YouTube for British Self University Derby, you'll get to the channel, and it'll be very easy to find it, to remind yourself of what I've said. I've recorded both this morning session and I'm recording this afternoon session because there are going to be differences. It just happens. It's not fully scripted. There's lots of ideas that I will talk about. The title, Leadership. Can we? Should we? All those things have been happening over the last couple of years in the field of big data, analytics, IoT, and so on. And we've seen a whole range of examples of things that we can do. Technically, we can do it. We can get the analytics to do the job for us. But there are occasions when we now have to start thinking very clearly in terms of what the vulnerabilities to our corporations or our businesses if we do this. Hence the should we question. I deal at university as an academic, as a lecturer in governance and analytics, purely in terms of questions. I teach my students no answers whatsoever. Because I've got a history now of best part of 48 years since I entered Rolls-Royce Aerospace as an undergrad apprentice. And the questions that we are asking about IT, computer science, network, security today are precisely and exactly the same questions as we were asking 30, 40, 50 years ago. The questions stay the same, the answers change in every company, in every organization across the years as well. So I teach, teach questions, not answers. I'm going to pose you a range of questions, a range of questions that you need to be thinking about to keep your companies secure, and that you, as leaders in your organisations, should also, I believe, be asking yourself. Hence, why I'm here, invited by Management Events. Briefly summarising the context, you've seen the list, I guess, of the fundamental questions. I'm going to look at a couple, the bottom two. That where is and what are your responsibilities, particularly in the area of the ethics of analytics? And secondly, or the point about the data-driven mindset. And I'm going to answer those two points, or address those two points, somewhat diagonally. Not providing answers, but pointers to how leaders in the field should be posing questions to themselves, to their organisations, in the next few months, because you have a date ahead of you, 25th of May 2018. Now, does anybody know why that date is important? Everybody know GDPR? How many of you know about GDPR and its impact on you? For those who don't know, just to concentrate minds just a little tiny bit, the figures, 20 million euros, or 4% of world turnover as penalties, are the problem. Whichever is the greater. And it affects anybody worldwide who is touching European citizens' data. So I'll give some examples later on where organisations outside of the EU in principle are at risk of extraordinary levels of fines come 25th of May next year. This is one of the leadership development sessions. So I need to address and define what leadership is about. I want to show very briefly in my own life story how that has affected me in ending up with me here as an academic, apparently. Why should I be here? What do I know about leadership or so on? And then I want to look at analytics governance, particularly in terms of this trust and ethics aspect. And because of the importance of GDPR, I'm going to look at issues of trust in relation to the data and our algorithms. And then I want to contrast big data and small data at the end. So, starting on that front, are you a manager allocating resources and tasks and getting stuff done? Very important task. But I'm addressing leadership, not management. They're two fundamentally different things, both of which are vital and critical in running an organization. Are you a manager? Or are you that person up front that sets the direction and people follow? Like that Middle Eastern shepherd who leads from the front. Very different to the European version of being a shepherd, where you are that. Very few places in Britain would you see anything other than the sheepdog or the shepherd and several sheepdog herding, shepherding their sheep along. This one is a different model. You may remember the quote, "My sheep know my voice, they will follow," or words that effect. Here's one perspective picture of some of the attributes of a leader. Someone who has a vision, a direction, and knows where to go, has a passion for what he's talking about or what she's talking about. And also, unlike some managers we know of, maybe some leaders even that we know of, they walk the talk. There's not one rule for you guys, and I'm the boss so I can have a different rule. I've seen that myself. Someone who's got integrity, is known for their integrity. They are excellent, if not brilliant, communicators. They know how to choose the message, the story, so that it aligns with and associates with the perspectives of their audience. Unlike a politician in Britain a few years ago who had something he was really passionate about, went out, delivered the message, and all of his audience rejected the message completely. Now, his response was interesting. It was, "The audience is stupid. It's the audience's problem that they didn't understand what I was saying." Now, politicians are ultimately one of the foremost proponents and exemplars of the art of communication and persuasion. To do that, you must know who your audience is. You must know a lot about what their likes and their preferences and their perspectives are. Otherwise, your story will not be received. It will be rejected. He should have looked at himself and said, "Actually, the fault was not them, it was me." So, if we're leaders, that part of that passion turns into extremely powerful communication processes and mechanisms that associate closely with the audience's understanding. And obviously, you need a degree of courage because you're going to be doing things which perhaps aren't being followed by the herd. You need to step out from that. If you look back at between 2004, 2007, 2008, with a credit crunch, there were quite a few leaders out there, or heads of companies, who were getting uncomfortable. They could begin to see that a bubble was happening that was going to be unsustainable. But very, very few of them actually admitted it because, well, the herd was there. Everybody was going in that direction, chasing after enormous levels of profit. Shareholders' meetings would have been very upset if boss of a company said, "No, I'm going to step off that roundabout, even if the music hasn't stopped, because it's too dangerous." Because they would say, with the short-termism that's prevalent in the stock market, "Let's keep making the money while it's there." needed courage. And those four or five people who made such a killing out of the derivatives around those subprime mortgages, they were exhibiting stunning levels of courage, if you've read their stories, because they were hanging in against all the evidence. And then suddenly, leading up to September 2008, it all fell apart and they made a killing. Why? Yeah, so courage is also important. Now, are those five attributes the only? Now, I would say, based on my career from undergraduate apprentice at Rolls-Royce in 1969 to where I am now, most of the time through Rolls-Royce and the last four or five years at University of Derby, I've been very lucky in terms of, yeah, there are quite a lot of managers there, but a lot of them were giving me the freedom, empowering me at least to do things which are new. I got a new job every 18 to 24 months as I moved through the company. And every one of them, or almost every one, was a brand new job that hadn't existed before, and I was given the opportunity and empowered to do interesting things that were of value to the organisation. And then when I got to University of Derby, well, normal academic career until 4 years ago. And that was when it was became very, very interesting indeed. I got two bosses, then head of department and assistant head of department, who fired me up, released me to go in a different direction to anything that most academics ever do. Most academics have a head full of cool, fantastic, amazing knowledge about their subject area. They want to ram into the heads of their students because it's good for them or it's fantastic and fun. Trouble is, most of it doesn't stick. We only learn for ourselves. We don't learn by listening, by and large. We have to do it. And so what they encouraged me to do was to move from being the technical expert, which I still am in some respects, but switch focus dramatically to where I am also inspiring and leading my students to learn how to learn. Learn how to do communication, soft skills. And what we've demonstrated this actually on one of the programs that I'm closely associated with, which is our analytics undergraduate program. Most universities who are doing these analytics programs, they will teach the students formally how to do SAS or click or jump or you name it. What we have done is quite different. Yeah, you can use SAS or maybe, and then here's the learning materials, go learn in your own time. In the workshops, you can come to us with any issues and any problems. We'll use CBT to prove that you've learned the technicalities, but then we're going to drive you in the soft skills, problem identification, solving, critical thinking, communication, collaboration. And then, at the end of the second semester, we're teaching them how to tell the story. A phrase has come into commercial conference and business conference in the last 24 months. Before that, you couldn't hear, almost never heard the word or the phrase. And suddenly, telling the story is becoming a really critical thing. And you guys have told us in universities around the world, you're okay at producing technically skilled students, so they can do the technical stuff, the mathematics and the analytics, all the this and this. But they are still unemployable because they don't have any of those soft skills. So I was encouraged to help lead this program away from the classic into this new way of soft skill-based assessment while the students learn technicalities and we teach them the questions. This is an extremely scary approach for a traditional academic because you're not teaching them content. But I was allowed and empowered and enthused and inspired to go that route. And we discovered something really interesting. A, the students love it, but much more importantly, their grades go up dramatically. So learning analytics to bring the term back into this play actually proves that what I was inspired to start leading with has actually worked. So that's how I'm here basically, and then through my LinkedIn profile, management events picked up on me this time last year to go down to Barcelona to do one of the keynotes, and then from that, suddenly, here I am. I was up in Helsinki 3 weeks ago, here I am in this session, then Copenhagen and Zurich at the end of in September, October. Because someone took the risk, had the courage to empower me to do interesting things that seems to have had some spectacular results academically, and hey, why am I here? Maybe hopefully you'll learn something from me about inspiration and empowerment, apart from the stuff that's now starting. If we look at the role of corporate leadership, the board of directors in English law, the UK Companies Act 2006, section 172, says these six things or so that they must consider when making decisions on behalf of the company. One is about the likely consequences of any decision in the long term, and E is a reputation for high standards of business conduct. Kind of ethics, trust, governance. Now, in the last 2 weeks, we have seen probably one of the most catastrophic series of reports about a massive and catastrophic failure of corporate business ethics. Do you all recognize those four little stories about Uber? For those of you who don't know what the stories are, that's the boss, the owner, Kalanick, having a rant at one of his drivers in very, very intemperate terms. The picture on the top is a report that the guy who moved from Google Cars to set up Otto, which is now owned by Uber, before he left, downloaded 14,000 technical files from Google, and took them with him to set up his new car company, new autonomous car company. It had all the design specifications for those boxes that go on top of the Google car, which took 5 to 10 years to develop. And it seems a bit suspicious that Uber, Otto, managed to recreate the stuff within 6 months or so. I suspect there is an allegation, or it is alleged that there will be a court case fairly rapidly on this one. The penalties, probably as judged by Uber, the court fines not going to be big enough to matter in relation to the benefit of 5 years short-circuiting of technical development. However, apparently the American law system has a lovely quirk in it that they can force the company to pause for as long as the source took to develop that technical capability. Added to which, in American law, there's some capability for fairly staggering example-making type of penalties as well. And then the bottom pair are really unpleasant. This is the HR type of environment where sexual harassment seemed to be running rife and nothing could be done to stop it. However often Susan Fowler complained, she was told, no, not going to do anything about that guy because he runs a successful team and we are encouraging success at all costs. And then the bottom left one, Amit Singhal, very sad, recruited from Google, I think, but it might not have been, and goes to Uber, has to resign within 4 weeks because he had failed to disclose some part of his history which related to sexual harassment. Not related to Susan Fowler, but part of the same kind of environment. It's almost catastrophic situation with a big company hoping to become one of the largest companies in the world. At least Kalanick has had the grace to say, I need leadership help. Let's hope it has an effect. Let's hope none of us are likely to get our companies into that sort of problem. I'm structuring the rest of the session in terms of data, algorithm, security and privacy because that relates to three critical parts of the GDPR that are relevant to all of us here as we use things like big data and analytics. And at the end, I just learned a little bit about comparing big data, which is what we mostly involved with, our SaaS and all the other analytics programs we use, and big data, with a completely different concept of small data, to see where that takes us. So starting with the idea of data. We're all involved in data coming from IoT-like devices, maybe the Canon camera tracker logger, our smartphones, fitness trackers, stuff out at the endpoints. We've also got things that capture data at the tills and go into corporate data environments, ERP systems and so on. We are collecting more data more rapidly in more varieties than ever before. And the problem is one of veracity. This was published back in 2012-13 or thereabouts by a guy called John Easton from IBM UK. And he pointed out that building on the fact that information now is following Moore's law, it's doubling every 18 months roughly, if not faster. But the point he was making is that all of that data is very uncertain. The problem is whether it's coming from GPS tracking, whether it's coming from fitness devices, or whether it's coming from the internet, social media, even our own enterprise data sources. Something like 80% or more of it is of uncertain veracity. Not that it's wrong, not that it's all wrong, but we cannot easily identify which data are right and which data are wrong, or by how much. And when I first saw that, back when John Easton actually presented it, I saw him. I was at a conference, he presented. I thought, because of my background at Rolls-Royce Aerospace, that stuff, that's clean, because I remember that when we implemented SAP in 2000, we had done a huge data cleanup exercise, throwing away the traditional 60, 70% of all the data that was in error, out of date, old, not necessary, and stuffed it in and were running. And I thought, that's going to be okay now. And then I began to pick up, in around about 2008 or 9, 10, that companies who'd done that and then run for 6, 8 years were having to redo the data cleanup exercise because it somehow got contaminated. And then 2 weeks ago, I kind of got confirmation of how that can happen. Not the causes of it, but that it had happened when I looked in on part of our PeopleSoft environment to discover that I was labelled in this particular bit as being in part of the university, the faculty that I'd worked in 5 years ago. And it hadn't changed, so I was still there as the updated name. It wasn't the business school any longer, it was now business law and something. So the changes of name had happened, but the change of allocation for me to it hadn't happened. So what did I do? Well, nothing. A, I don't know who to go to see. Can't be bothered to find out because it has no consequence to me. It is in that particular part of the system, it has absolutely no consequence to me or anybody else. So why should I bother wasting 15, 20 minutes of my time, which is more important for doing other things with students or conferences. There are other bits in there that show for me where, as long as there's no consequence for me, I can't be bothered to change it if it takes more than 10 seconds to fix. And that's without the Pareto principle that when we implement these big corporate systems, we only provide something like 20% of the functionality that drives 80% of the activity, leaving the 80% of the functionality that gives 20% of the functionality not provided for. But the customers don't stop asking for it. The world will not stop and cooperate. So your users then will bend the system in one way or another so they can record what they've done to keep the customer satisfied. That makes for uncertain data. So having got that there, now what problems does that raise for us? Well, if you are involved with location data, because you want to record where people are or analyze where they are, following the roads or as they travel by train, you can track them through the telecoms, cell connections, or you can pick up, like Amazon and Apple do, through their location services tracking, you know where people are. Or do you? I've been doing getting my undergraduate student. It's all right. There we are. I've been getting my undergraduate students now to be doing some research on how accurate the assisted GPS is in terms of tagging photos off their smartphones for the last 2-3 years. Triggered by the fact I took 4 photos up where that block at the top are, and found when I got back to the hotel that one of them was about 22 kilometres out of place. Now that's all right if I'm just taking photos and kind of tag them just because it's entertaining. But if you're a business who is trying to send out location tagged adverts to where you believe your customers are, you have a potential reputational vulnerability if you send an advert to someone to go to a Starbucks, say in Amsterdam, and they're down in actually in Hilversum, which is sort of 30 kilometres different. It's kind of irritating, it's a bit like spam. I've had 1 or 2 photos which are tagged 1,000 kilometres in error. A bother. Now, a company called ThinkNear in the USA analyse the errors of billions of location-targeted adverts every year. And their analysis shows that something like 15% of all location-targeted adverts end up more than 60 miles, 100 kilometres out of place. The emergency services in some of the cities in the USA are having a problem because they like to have, they like you to have your app on here to locate where you are when you phone in for an emergency, fire, etc. Problem is, if you are indoors in sort of buildings like that, it's quite likely it's not going to locate you in the right building at all. And if there are 50 floors, it's going to be very unlikely that it's going to get anywhere near the right altitude, the right height. That GPS tracker of mine has problems of being 10, 15 metres altitude difference from where I am. When I took a series of photos on Montréal in Montreal, startup error for about 5 kilometres, and at no point did the altitude over a period of 25 minutes on my phone get anywhere near the altitude that the top of Montréal actually is. It's about 30 metres low. So 30 metres is going to be the equivalent of sort of 10 floors. Consequences. Almost all IoT sensor devices are inaccurate in one way or another. And if you're looking at fitness trackers, they can be anything up to 30% different. Consequences? We'll see. But you have to remember that these things are not accurate. If I compare that Garmin Vivo Smart with my steps counting on my iPhone, there's about 30% error, or difference, should I say. And I tend to believe the step counting on the iPhone more than I believe the step counting on the Garmin, because it's unlikely that I do 10,000 steps a day and he keeps telling me I am. I just don't do that much walking around, unless all this moving like this actually generates steps at a great rate of knots. And that shows the pattern between the two over a period of about a week and a half. Another area of data that we're all trying to use is social media in all sorts of interesting ways. And the thing is, if I can hoover up all of the tweets about a subject, then obviously I've got all the data, haven't I? And in statistics terms, in terms of sample size, I have n equals all, because that's all there is. Actually, no. You have got an astoundingly biased set of data. If you look at almost any blog where people can respond, or any chat environment, if you have, I mean, I did some work analysis about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, of an environment where sort of people were posting stuff about international and humanitarian type law. And there were, I could, over a period of a year, I could count about 1,000 people who actually posted at some point in time. How many other people out lurking there who didn't post, I have no idea, I didn't have access to that, but I suspect tens of thousands. But in terms of the real activity, in terms of the main posting, I think it was about 15 of that 1,000 who ever posted about 90% of all of the posts. I was talking to a restaurateur a few weeks ago that I know quite well, been going to his restaurant cafe for 10, 12 years. And he said he doesn't bother looking at at Facebook or these sort of trackers, because all that's on there are adverse points. And he knows broadly when each one of those was pointed, and he knows exactly what happened inside his restaurant. And not one of those people actually went to talk to the management to complain about the service. They went home and then blasted from the distance of privacy. And there are no positive comments on that website at all for him. Because let's face it, why? If I get the service I like, expect, why should I? Marketeers have known for 35, 40 years, if I have a bad experience, I will tell 10 people. That's face to face. If I have what I expect, I'm happy, I might, possibly, maybe, tell 3 people. Check it out next time you have a good experience and you have a bad experience, and see how many people you tell each of those. Try it. So can we believe the data that we are mining from there? We can believe that it's probably the truth as perceived by those who post, but it is probably not a representative sample of what the whole of your customer base is thinking. Lots to say about accuracy of data and so on from a GDPR perspective, haven't got time. Second critically important area is algorithms. And when Marcel and I were discussing what to do in this session, he came up with the article that leads to the Cambridge Analytica point. But there are some interesting business and ethics consequences about that, about the activity trackers, and about the story about Target. Who knows the Target story about pregnancy prediction? Just 2 or 3. Good. Now, Cambridge Analytics is a company that helped in the Brexit campaign in the UK and helped with Trump's political campaign that led to him being elected as president. But the story goes back a little bit further to a guy called Michael Kaczynski, and he discovered something very, very interesting. He and his team at Cambridge University discovered that if they analysed something like 69 likes on Facebook, they could, with an 85% confidence level predict your skin colour? 69 likes. And they know whether you're a white Caucasian or black African. Stunning. They discovered if they could analyse 150 likes, broadly speaking, they understood you better than your parents. That is the power of analytics. Alexander Nix of a company called Cambridge Analytica. Whether he used that basic stuff that Mike Kaczynski had developed or not, it was a development of the approach. And what he was able, or his company were able to do, both for Brexit and for Trump, was to allow the politicians, the marketing people, to be able to deliver extremely highly nuanced communications on an individual basis in a way that connected with perfect communication principles to your belief system. And so the message going to every single recipient was going to be subtly different. But yet they all poured in behind the Brexit campaign or the Trump campaign. Now, there's obviously other things happening as well, but this is an incredibly powerful use of analytics to change the way that political canvassing works. Instead of here are our sort of basic principles and policies and our this is what we stand for, it's, well, actually, we stand for something subtly different for every single one of you out there, even if we're nothing like any of that. Raises some very interesting questions about business ethics and the use of analytics. Target was fun. Back in the early 2000s, the marketeers at Target had an idea. They wanted to find out. Well, they knew one thing, that women who are pregnant have kind of flexible preferences. They vary a bit. And what they wanted to be able to do was to use that preference plasticity and through targeted marketing techniques, particularly books of coupons, they wanted to expose these pregnant women to the fact that Target sells everything, not just the few things they normally go there for, but the whole gamut. So they set the challenge to their analytics team, and they sort of did stuff, and it's a fabulous challenge to the technicians. Marvelous challenge to data scientists. Can you predict, can you identify pregnant women for a start, and two, can you predict when they're going to come to term? And it turned out the answer to both of those was yes, we can. We can identify pregnant women based on the changes from before, through, and after. And we can actually tell roughly which trimester, and as they get further in, almost which month the baby's going to be coming. And they thought this was fantastic until the press went in. And then the sky fell in after the big stories. A very, very angry man appeared in one of the shops demanding see the store manager and was waving a whole book of coupons. And the opening gambit was, what are you trying to do? Get my daughter pregnant? She's only 16. The manager hadn't been told about this happy practice. Very apologetic. And said, I'll get back to you in a week when I found out what's going on. Phones up in a week, and the first thing was the father said, terribly sorry, there's things going on in the family I didn't know about. The daughter hadn't told us. She'd not been brave enough. The ethical question there is, should they have done the analysis? In other words, was there a question they should not ethically check, ask of their data, or can you ask any question, but then the ethics comes in as what you do with it? Were they unethical? They certainly took a huge risk, it turns out, with their reputation. Their reputational vulnerability was pretty impressive. And health trackers. If they're inaccurate, does it matter? In some respects, no. But we discover that people are looking at their trackers and saying, oh, I'm going to target 2,500 calories a day, and I've just done my run, and I've got done 4,000 calories, so I can go and have my Big Mac as a reward. Wrong answer. If you've done that extra calories, that means you've burnt a little extra weight. So what's happening is people are not getting fitter and trimmer because they're believing the machinery and they're misusing it, making the wrong decisions. They're getting fatter. Okay, that's a personal impact. No significant consequence really to the manufacturers, except they should warn people even more that they're not very accurate. But that kind of ruins the sales pitch. More consequential is the fact that both health, human and pet health schemes are now coming up, which say, if you have a fitness tracker and you meet your targets, we will reduce your premium by, in the USA, $500 a year, dollars a year, and in the UK, sorry, is it still there? Yeah, sorry. One of them has actually gone to the extreme of saying, if you don't meet your health target each week, there's a £12, €15 penalty to pay week by week if you fail to meet your targets. Now, I challenge that as a business ethics problem, that you've got inaccurate data there driving this sort of thing. If I was using that and I was allowed to use that Garmin tracker, I would use that because I know I can, if I go like that for about 10 minutes, I've got an extra 2,000 steps. I can't fail to meet my target with that because it's so inaccurate. Bad deal for the company. And for the pet health tracking, you've got one of these things, we'll give you this, as long as your Golden Labrador does 80 minutes. Experiment was done, end of 80 minutes of exercise for the dog, 5 minutes recorded. That's not good news either. Machine learning. This is important because of the transparency of algorithms aspect under GDPR. How certain can we be, or are we, about what these machine learning algorithms are learning? There's a lovely story going around, which I believe is true, of the military trying to train some sort of visual recognition system to track, to tell the difference between enemy tanks and friendly tanks. Trained it up with a huge, huge, huge training set and then tested it, and it was perfect within the training set. The only problem is those two pictures give you the exact message that it had learned. Actually, it had learned to distinguish between forests and deserts, if you believe one story, or sunlight or sunny skies and cloudy skies, whichever. Neither of which is remotely relevant to what is actually being wanted, which is that thingy there, or those. Hadn't learnt that at all. And it was entirely accidental when they discovered it. Neural networks are staggeringly dangerous because we have no idea what they're doing. There's no way of getting inside the neural network to learn, to identify what they've learned. Someone has come up with this lovely idea of a brain scan of a neural network. It's actually nothing like a scan. Well, it's kind of like human fMRI scans, where we can see which bits of the brain are lighting up when we're talking and thinking and doing things. And the idea of these brain scans of neural networks, the way they've termed it, is such that you think that is telling you what it's doing. It's something completely different, but it's just shown in a way that helps us, well, cons us into thinking it's like a brain scan, so we can see where it's doing things or why it's doing things. But we don't know what neural networks do at all in terms of real facial recognition or anything else. That's important when you start thinking about tracking people through the underground systems with all of the cameras. How do we know it's tracking the right face from there to there to there? Because we don't understand what it's doing in its visual recognition mechanism. Serious GDPR impact there, probably. Security and privacy by design is fundamental to GDPR. There are going to be lots of people who are likely to catch that €20 million 4%. Those two companies on the left, on the right, almost certainly would have got done big time. You've heard of the little Kayla doll in Germany, where people have been recommended to burn their dolls ASAP because they connect through the internet between your child, your baby, and parents on their smartphones. The people who do cloud pets had a database which gives a connectivity between the doll, the teddy bear, and the parents. 821,000 sets of ID on a totally unprotected, unpassword protected, on anything protected server on the internet, which allowed you to find out what my granddaughter perhaps was saying to her mummy. That's 20 million euros. Bang. Without a shadow of a doubt. And Kayla as well. Or your smart fridge as well. Yeah. Your smart fridge is now a problem. There's a case where a retailer had their corporate network hacked through their smart fridge. Finally, big data, small data. Does anybody remember the Amazon programs called Alpha House? Anybody? No, didn't expect you to. We've all heard of House of Cards from Netflix, haven't you? Small data-ish versus big data on the left. Contrast two totally different approaches to using big data analytics. Both companies do pilot programs. Both collect huge amounts of data about how their customers are viewing stuff. But the difference is that with Alpha House and Amazon just did the analytics and then chose the leading program and then delivered it exactly as the program. Pilot. House of Cards was different. Yeah, all that big data analytics. But then that was just the starting point of how the Netflix team then developed their programs. They then started the human task. Small data, the middle-sized data, intuition, judgment, experience. And from that, they built five, have now had, five series of House of Cards. Working straight from the analytics, the pure data, Amazon came up with something that failed basically was canned after two series. So the message from that is that you need to keep human involvement in decision-making and making judgments. You cannot use analytics and big data to get rid of human intuition and human experience. Yes. Lots and lots of proponents say, yeah, we get rid of all the decision-makers and so on, because we've got analytics that tells us everything about N equals all. No. Contrast that with Martin Lindstrom's book and his experience in small data. He saved Lego by observing, or his team saved Lego by observing in the house of a 13-year-old kid a pair of trainers which were battered. And it turned out that the fundamental message was that no, those millennials are not time poor for the things they want to do. He had infinite time to develop mastery of his skateboarding. He wanted the complexity in the Lego kit so that he could spend lots and lots and lots of time acquiring mastery that he could then show to his friends and demonstrate he was the master of Lego in the town. Where would you find that message in big data? He did the same with the company over there, Lowe's Food. Contrasted with Walmart, who do everything on big data. Small company, almost family run in the Carolinas. Having problems. Big data wouldn't have told him the answers. He went and talked to individual people. He connected the ideas to work he'd done in marketing in the Soviet Union, Saudi Arabia. That gave him some insight they helped him to understand what it really was that was going to make this company successful again. It's to do with things like freedom. We think of America as a land of the free. Actually, so he said, it turns out to be the land where everybody thinks about freedom and everybody is not free because they are so constrained by peer pressures. They do not want to stand out. Interesting. Slightly paraphrased. Read the story. The rest of the slides I'm not going to go through, we haven't got time, but you will be able to get, you can get out the slides already in PDF form, and they'll say the video will be there as well. But this link will be valuable to all of you. It comes from the Information Commissioner's Office in the UK as an analysis of some of the important aspects of AI, big data, and GDPR, machine learning. It's very, very well written. It's incredibly clear in what it, in its writing. It's not one of these turgid, difficult things. It's really, really easy. 114 pages, and it's amazingly valuable. So the next three or four identify some of the critical questions about GDPR in terms of data, analytics, algorithms, machine learning. Oh, and also, of course, security and privacy by design. So I leave you with a question. Where will you lead? Will you be a leader? Will you be a manager? Will you set a direction which is founded on ethics and trust? I'll leave you with these books, which are very, very interesting. And then the rest is lots of sources and a series of 12 charts with the 12 Vs. Big data, 12 Vs of IT, informatics, computer science. Lots of notes as well with them. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Time for questions.
Okay, thank you, Richard. Anyone questions for Richard? Based on the topic.
Do you share the presentation afterwards?
The presentation is already online. I'll get management events to sort of circulate the URLs for this and for the video when I've posted it up. And if anybody wants to talk with me afterwards, just talk to the management events desk, and if you want to one-to-one, I'm free till certainly till the till 5 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Verder met twee presentaties van Ruud Haan, die ons mee gaat nemen naar hoe data uit publieke bronnen gebruikt kan worden. Dat zal die presentatie, hij zit hier al, dat goed. Die zal hij hier gaan doen. En Jonas Bunk die gaat verhaal houden waar onder andere de competenties die nodig zijn om te komen tot het bouwen van een analytics center. Gaat hij aan ons toelichten, maar dat doet hij in een andere zaal. En dat is hierboven om de hoek. En daar staan mensen.